Madame l'ambassadrice et cher Emmanuel, monsieur l'ambassadeur, cher Paul, monsieur l'ancien président du Parlement européen et aussi parfait francophone, it's a great pleasure and actually I feel privileged to express myself to express my views in your institute today. I am aware and we remember that during our lunch of the great work that is done here by the chair Brendan Halligan, the director who is not here, Dohi O'Kelly, and the director of research, Mrs. Jill Donahue. Not to mention the pleasure to have this session chaired by Joe Mulholland, an outstanding French speaker and old friend of our country. As your impressive list of speakers demonstrates, the IIEA has been recognized for a long time now as Ireland's most prominent think tank on European and international affairs. At a time of crisis, deep crisis in Europe, institutes like yours provide business leaders, politicians, academics, and citizens, above all citizens, with the most valuable ideas and thoughts on how to build a better future for all of us. And I shall know in this context, try to tell you a few words, I hope I will not be too long, on France in Europe today, after the changes occurred during the last spring in our political scene, and shall be happy to answer to some questions, if there are enough time. First of all, ever since the post-war era, France has had, I think, a clear political vision for the European construction, which has remained quite unchanged to this day. Overcoming nationalist divisions and ensuring sustainable peace and prosperity on the continent. For us, the European Union is much more than a large market and a free trade area. It also gives Europe more weight to defend its interests globally and its values in the world. Today, the European Union is facing, we all know that, probably one of the most serious crises in its history. But as the world's largest economy, economic and trading power, strengthened by its status and exceptional heritage, in cultural terms in general, it has the means of overcoming this crisis by transcending national interests as much as possible. Now, it's not the time for resignation, none at all, or withdrawing into ourselves, but despite the emergence of such tendencies and actions which fuel or which are fueled by populist movements, and we also know that very well in France. Now, less than ever, can the EU member states, which are so closely interconnected, and I mean, not only through the rules of the European Union, but through their whole history. No one can afford to act in an uncoordinated fashion. No single state can face up to the economic and geostrategic challenges on its own. The idea is not to surrender our sovereignty, nor to reclaim a very relative sovereignty for our countries, which are extremely open to the outside world in a time of very rapid globalization, but rather to pool our sovereignties. Shared sovereignties, sovereignty in Europe means, I think, we think, regain sovereignty for each member states, each member state. At the core of the European integration, for us, is solidarity among all member states, together with the individual responsibility of each of them. The causes of the crisis are well known. For years, developed countries have spent beyond their means and become more indebted, in particular to emerging countries. Europe has been particularly hard hit due to the lack of a common budgetary and exchange rate policy in comparison with the single monetary policy. Because of the worrying disparities between our different countries, especially as regards competitiveness and debt, both public and private, confidence has seriously been shaken. The volatile, sometimes irrational markets, along with banks worrying about their own insolvency, as well as that of states, required such a hike in interest rates on certain countries' government bonds that the darkest prophecies became self-fulfilling. But I really think that the EU has the means to meet this or those challenges. When Ireland was first hit by the crisis, the EU acted to help it to overcome its difficulties with France's full support and commitment. Almost 2 years later, we can know only really a command and thank you, Paul. Can we only command and admire really Ireland's progress? I know that you have internal political debates, and but really the balancing of public accounts and the consolidation of balance sheets enabled a substantial cut in interest rates and led to increased investor confidence, which is really back. Ireland is really a model, as it shows that with the full support of Europe, steps can be taken to deal with the crisis and to start to overcome it. We don't want the sovereign debt crisis to weaken the cohesion between the EU member states or to create north-south or east-west division inside our Europe. Consideration must, however, be given to the operation of the Eurozone and its link with the other member states. The urgent nature of the crisis led us to take important decisions and to adopt new tools, which allows us to respond now to the markets. Significant progress, which was unimaginable only 1 or 2 years ago, has enabled us to set up a regulatory framework, which a credible instrument such as the European Financial Stability Facility and tomorrow, I hope, after ratification, the European Stability Mechanism. The results of the Eurozone summits of the last June will allow soon, I hope, this mechanism to directly recapitalize banks without involving necessarily states. And of course, let's us pay and express our admiration for the very courageous, in this framework, decision taken yesterday by the Board of Governors of the European Central Bank. For us, at least, we have a central bank which is playing its role. At the same time, our governments have decided to establish a genuine supervisory system for banks, mainly provided by the European Central Bank. We are still waiting, but next week for the proposal of the European Commission and Commissioner Barnier in particularly. The events of autumn 2008 showed that the regulators had failed and that action at a national level was insufficient to require banks to introduce essential regulation of their activities in the EU. Furthermore, each state must accept to put in place structural reform, reforms, which will pay off in the long term. And even if it's painful, we all know that, especially here and in other countries in Europe, including France, and we will have also hard work, hard time in front of us, I think, in our country, and implement both, so fiscal consolidation policies, but we also think that it is absolutely necessary to implement also proactive measures to support growth. The French government, the new French government, is determined to fulfill its commitment that was taken especially by Mr. Hollande during the electoral campaign, to fulfill its commitment and balance public accounts. François Hollande was perfectly clear about the need to go back to a budget which is more which was managed in a more responsible way. It is for this reason that at the beginning of next month, the government will ask to the Parliament to ratify the Treaty on Stability, Coordination and Governance in the EMU and to pass what we call in French an organic law, that is a special framework law which will establish a new binding system for public finance planning laws. But budgetary restraint will not be enough, as austerity alone would lead to a deflationary spiral, which would adversely affect tax revenues and encourage recession. This is why France wanted the European Council last June to take this new balanced approach by adopting a series of coherent measures to stimulate growth, totaling 120 billion euros. This compact growth and jobs comprises, as you know, an increase in capital of the European Investment Bank, and I hope that it will be done as soon as possible, with the capacity of increasing the lending power of the bank of by 60 billion euros. In the same vein, structural funds of around 55 billion euro were available and will be reallocated in order to promote growth, especially through promoting innovation, research, and modernization of our economies. And thirdly, we count a lot on this first experiment of project bonds, which will start only with a 5 billion euros project, but we do hope that as soon as possible, including after the recapitalization of the European Investment Bank, we will be able to have, as soon as possible, a second and more consistent program in order to support project that could really influence growth in Europe, especially in sectors like energy saving, new energies, transports, communications, etc. So that's why we must go further in order to achieve sustainable growth. Firstly, beyond this first decision, the internal market can be an important source of growth. the deepening of the internal market is far from complete, as large gaps still exist. France has worked towards a genuine unitary patent, for instance, and has made many compromises to that end. It already represents a significant progress for the EU competitiveness, and I hope that in spite of the final disputes about the seat of the judiciary organs, will be able to conclude this and to switch to a situation in which we will really have a European patent system. French public opinion sometimes views the internal market as a threat to public services. We must correct this perception. I'm sure that this government will do its utmost to do that and to strengthen our citizens' trust through common rules which encapsulate our social and environmental ambitions. The internal market is not only deregulation, but it has also to again incorporate those environmental and social concerns, like it was the case in the Mario Monti's 2010 report. Neither must we neglect the external aspect of the internal market. Opening up our economies is an important principle to which we are totally committed, but this would not prevent us from taking action when we believe our companies are up against unfair competition. It is for that reason that France is a firm supporter, and that this has not changed between Sarkozy and Hollande, a firm supporter of reciprocity as regards access to third country public procurement markets, especially in the major emerging countries. While 80% of public markets in Europe are open, maybe a bit more, even more, in Canada, for instance, which is not really an emerging country, it's the case for fewer than 30%, while in China and Brazil, the percentage is probably around 20%. The European Union has awarded 312 billion euros of public contracts to foreigners during the last years, while our American friends has only done so to the tune of 34 billion euros or dollars, euros. So campaigning for reciprocity in this area has nothing to do with protectionism, all the contrary. Indeed, it is quite the opposite. It is not a question of closing our borders, but rather opening border in other countries. And I think that, for instance, the recent decision of by the Commission to open an anti-dumping case against China for a solar panel is a very important decision. Furthermore, we need, according to our country, I know that it's not totally always totally shared in the Union, but we think that we need a genuine industrial strategy to promote production within Europe itself, efforts to increase competitiveness and mobilize European research and innovation policies, which will facilitate the competitive production of high value added goods and services in Europe. And I do think that we really share the same views between Ireland and France on that aspect, as in other many aspects. Despite severe budgetary constraints, Ireland has continued to invest in innovation and excellence in education as drivers for growth. We must give this objective our wholehearted support, in particular as regards defining the new multi-year financial framework for 2014-2020, which will no doubt will be a difficult task that will, it's not a prophecy. I mean, if we can succeed before, let's do it. But this, the conclusion of this package, this new financial package, will probably fall under the responsibility of the Irish presidency, taking into account the difficulties of the equation. In this regard, I would like to recall that for France, the common agricultural policy, as for Ireland, is a future-oriented one, which has seen great technology and is still seeing great technological progress. It's also a big source of employment. For instance, in France, the agri-food industry and the agriculture accounts for 15% of the workforce. And it's also, for us, a matter of global sovereignty in the world, which we must never forget, taking into account, for instance, the incredible efforts made, for instance, by China to conquer lands and to develop agricultural production all around the world. It's also kind of a very important source of soft power. And like you, like the Irish people, we are determined to support European agriculture in those negotiations. I would also like to clarify our position on another point. As we see, the financial transaction tax can be a lever for growth, and it would have a broad base. The Commission was proposing a rate of 0.1% for shares and bonds, and 0.001 on other financial products. A portion of the resulting revenue, around 60 billion euros across the European Union, according to the Commission's calculations, could be allocated, according to us, to stimulus spending. From a moral standpoint, we believe it's totally logical that the financial sector, whose profits in some cases remain huge, very huge, despite significant funds have been raised to bail out banks, so that the financial sector should contribute to the general European economic revival. We would like all 27 countries of the EU to move forward on this issue together, but if there is no unanimity, we will focus on enhanced cooperation, which is allowed by the treaty, at least as soon as 9 states have taken the decision to introduce such a tax. For all these reforms, institutional reform will later on maybe be required. But at this point, we believe that we must use the tools provided by the treaties of Lisbon to overcome this crisis, which demands immediate action before rushing into a new long-term project. This is the framework for President Herman Van Rompuy's important proposals on a true economic and monetary union, which aims to compare and pull together the existing tools along with an enhanced political integration, what the new president of the French Republic, François Hollande, calls intégration solidaire, which we could translate, according to Paul Kavanagh, as integration in solidarity or integration through solidarity. We await further details in the interim report due in October from Van Rompuy, and then in the final report in December, including on the increased role of the European Parliament and national parliaments in order to improve accountability in this strengthened economic and monetary union. Although we are concerned about our economic situation, we must not lose sight of security risks and the importance of upholding our interests and values. The European Union's external action has been increased, and we commend the work, which is not too bad after only one year and a half of the European External Action Service, and especially the role of Mrs. Ashton, which enable us to better speak with a single voice, even if it's not every day perfect. But for instance, we have made really a shift to the capacity of being, I don't know if we are listened, but at least to speak loudly, for instance, to people like the Iranians. To be effective, we must act together on critical issues such as Syria or the Sahel, which is a major threat really so close to our borders. Of course, in discussions also with our neighbors in the southern Mediterranean and Eastern Europe, and with our major global partners. At a time when the emerging powers are increasing their armament efforts, and very strongly, for instance, in the case of China or Russia, and geostrategic upheavals are taking place on our doorstep, it is essential that we step up our diplomatic, defense, and security efforts. All EU countries must play a part, and in spite of its special inheritance of neutrality, I'm sure that Ireland will play its role as it has done, for instance, in commanding the EU force in Chad years ago, in directing this force. The consolidation of the Eurozone, I will try to end, will no doubt mean a multi-speed Europe, but on no account a Europe where each country can cherry-pick what it pleases without accepting the common rules or request to take part in decisions with no intention of applying them, implementing them. We should strive for unanimity, for consensus wherever is possible, but if a consensus cannot be reached, a small minority must not hinder the majority who want to progress. Under certain conditions, the Treaty of Lisbon provided, I remember it, for the establishment of enhanced cooperation, provided that at least 9 member states participate in it. We are applying that mechanism, for instance, for the European Unitary Patent, precisely, or tomorrow for the Financial Transaction Tax, and must continue to do so. Naturally, it's not a question of excluding those countries which, for a wide variety of reasons, choose not to be in. The Schengen agreements, the euro, and the Treaty on Stability, Coordination and Governance of last December have variable geometry. They must be provided with effective mechanism for ensuring links between the different level, and we should pay a very strong attention during the next month and year to this articulation between 27, 25, and 17, or sometimes fewer countries. And I conclude, the French government wants to engage in dialogue with all member states and all relevant institutions. We discussed that during our lunch. Probably the latest years were not totally satisfactory from this point of view in our European policy. We want to engage more with an institution like the European Parliament, which is now acquired a decisive role in the European system, with our national parliaments, with the Commission, with the European Central Bank. France's special relationship with Germany sometimes gives rise to misunderstandings. For us, European construction and French-German reconciliation go hand in hand. You all know the history, the close links between the two countries, which have been forged throughout European construction, which is totally interlinked with it, and that we will celebrate next year and under at the occasion of the 50th anniversary of the Élysée Treaty of January 63. So this allows us to hold close dialogue on all European issues and to reconcile our position, which are not always the same and quite often are not the same. And this reconciliation, when we can reach an agreement, make easier, according to us, to reach an agreement then between the 27 countries. On the contrary, when France and Germany fail to agree, achieving consensus among the EU is much more difficult. This is also quite normal, as France and Germany together account for half of the Eurozone total gross domestic product. But again, this relationship for us, and this is very clear from Mr. Hollande's point of view, cannot be exclusive. We discussed that at lunch. The French government wants to strengthen cooperation much more than it has done during the last 5 years, with all partners, and first and foremost with the future Irish presidency, in order to meet together the huge and stimulating challenges that our country and your country as a presidency will face. Our two countries has already started collaborating to that end, especially we had a very long, very in-depth discussion this morning. This, I think, is really, and we also had this discussion at lunch, is in harmony with the historic friendship between our two nations, which goes back far in centuries and which has been a bit neglected, maybe, during the last year. So, naturally, France will stand alongside Ireland in preparing and realizing what promises to be, again, a challenging semester. Thank you so much for your attention. I'm ready to answer your questions. Thank you.